Shoes. Recorded live.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to By Yahweh's Design. I am Pastor Dan, your host for this live radio broadcast. And today is the 28th day of August, year 2016, and we've entitled today's program, Meet Mark Sargent. And this should be quite controversial. Before we begin, we do dedicate this program to our Heavenly Father, Yahweh, who is the great I Am. We also dedicate this program to His holy remnant, who are the believing sons and daughters of Jacob, who was later named Israel. Today, these people are known as the Caucasian or the true Israelite peoples of the world. Hallelujah, which means all praise Yahweh in ancient or Paleo-Hebrew. To my Welsh kinsmen across the ocean, Shumai, and welcome to the program. If you have a comment or question for myself or for Mark during the broadcast, don't be afraid to call in. The area code is 724. The phone number is 444-7444. The ID number for this program, of course, is 25929. A quick reminder, we do have a new website, PastorDan.net, and my email address if you need help, assistance, or consultation is bydpastordan@yahoo.com. Our two famous quotes real quick, and then we'll bring Mark onto the program here. Thomas Jefferson said that when injustice becomes law, resistance becomes duty. And Thomas Paine said that the strength and power of despotism consists wholly in the fear of resistance. And Mark, can you hear me?
I can hear you.
Oh, excellent, excellent. Okay, very good. Again, ladies and gentlemen, Mark Sargent, first-time guest here on By Yahweh's Design. And so, Mark, as usual, if you don't mind, I'm going to put you on the spot and have you give a short bio of yourself so everybody pretty much knows who you are and how you got where you are today.
Sure. I was born and raised on Whidbey Island, Washington, and started my career playing computer games for a living, believe it or not, out in Boulder, Colorado. And while I was out there, I was into conspiracies for a number of years. And then in the middle of 2014, I kind of stumbled across something which, again, seemed ridiculous at the time, which was, you know, what shape is our actual world? And I didn't believe it, like anyone, and the t-shirt will come out eventually, which says, I got into flat earth, or I became a flat earther because I tried to debunk flat earth. And that's exactly what happened. For the next 9 months, all the way up until February of last year, I tried to stomp this thing into the ground. There was no way it could be real. Everyone knows, the earth is a globe, and, that's that. And after 9 months, I had a weird isn't really even a word for it, a Jerry Maguire moment, if anyone knows the movie reference, where I woke up at 3:30 in the morning on February 10th of last year, and I had the entire narrative in my head where I basically sat down and I started building something which is now known as the Flat Earth Clues, where I laid out in small, easy-to-digest chunks, the question that I put to the internet was, I don't think it's a globe anymore, and I can't even prove the globe at this point, so tell me that I'm wrong. And, I immediately thought, that scientists or some sort of academic elite would call me up or shoot me an email or something, because my email and phone number is out there for everybody to see, and say, okay, well, you are wrong, and here's why. And it didn't happen. As a matter of fact, not only did it not happen as I was building the clues, I started getting calls for interviews, and then things started snowballing from there. Sorry, it's a little early. I haven't had my tea yet. And then, after the interviews I had, started getting subject matter experts to where now, here we are 18 months later, and it's grown into something amazing, where it's the retention rate. Anybody that goes into this topic, and I got to warn anyone that's listening here, look, if you go down this road, there's a good possibility you're going to, you know, come out the other side as being a flat earther. I know that sounds absolutely ridiculous, and probably some of the people listening now are you know, either tuning out or hanging up or writing in a forum or writing you a nasty letter. And I get this on just about every show I do. Look, I'm just the messenger here. All I can tell you is that science for the last 500 years has been telling you something, and it seems like it's straight out of a Twilight Zone episode or a science fiction movie of the week, but that's exactly what it is. The question, and we'll get into this as we keep going, is let's say, you know, because until NASA could prove it, you know, in the 1950s, let's say everything that science said about the shape of the world, let's say they were wrong. Let's say they found out about it, you know, in the 1950s. Would they tell the general public? And as I was digging into this, I realized, you know, 100%, that no, of course they wouldn't, because, you know, men don't like to relinquish power easily. And so they just kept this thing under wraps, and between the United States and the Soviet Union, or the former Soviet Union, they've kept the secret going for about 60 years, and you know, that's where we are now. So that's my intro. That's my dark and brooding 7 a.m. on West Coast time intro.
Yeah, we do want the folks to understand that it's pretty early in the morning for you, so we do appreciate it.
Yeah. Oh, no. I've done earlier shows at this, but it's this early, I'm not as peppy as usual, so I'm just kind of, I'm giving you the down and dirty thing. But I got to go into more about my bio, you know, since this is a Christian-based show, yes?
Well, we cover everything. I like to just call myself a believer. We're non-denominational. We don't believe the mainstream churches are just as much liars as NASA.
Okay.
So we're all about truth here. That's the main thing, and we believe the Bible correctly interpreted is truth. Our Heavenly Father is truth. Christ said, "I'm the truth, the way, and the life," and we believe that to be 100% true. So, and my bringing you onto the program is not just a personal desire. I've had a lot of requests. They continue to come in. This is so controversial a topic, especially amongst believers, because I don't understand why, Mark, but for some reason, a lot of people who say they are believers think somehow that this is heresy to even discuss this notion, whereas I find that incredulous for this reason.
Yeah.
It seems obvious to me that if I were an enemy who wanted to make people docile, make people apostate, make people atheistic, what better way than to come up with this notion that we're a ball spinning around in the middle of nothing versus what was believed for thousands and thousands of years by the smartest, brightest people of our kind, which is the prophets and the many great schools such as the Druids and many others, who understood that this was not. This is exactly what Scripture says, an immovable platform that's enclosed, which is exactly what the Hebrew and Greek words mean, a protected or enclosed earth. Why is it such a difficult subject to broach? I mean, do you have any thoughts on that?
Oh yeah, you bet I do, because that's what I've been dealing with pretty much nonstop since this thing started, which is there's two big reasons. The biggest reason, though, is because of our conditioning. As much as, you know, and I'm not going to pick on any one religion that's out there or any individual that believes in whatever text, but you can say what you want about believing the text as, you know, as the truth, right? But it is really tough to do that and at the same time go through the education system. And I don't care what education, whether it's private or public or whatever, you know, even homeschool, you know, what most people will teach the globe. The globe conditioning is so complete that it turns this topic very, very polarizing. So what I mean by that is, for anyone that's out there listening, you know how you got first conditioned to it, but it's subtle. You have to remember it, and that is, look, when you got into first grade, there was a globe in your classroom just sitting there, and the teacher didn't have to necessarily show it to you or spin it around or anything. It was just there, and it was always in your visual cue, And every day, you know, for that you went to school from, you know, if you went through high school, you know, 12 years, you know, the CIA pays good money for that sort of conditioning, and you did it for free. And, you know, not only that, you know, all the science books and all the sciences that we are exposed to, you know, geology, hydrology, biology, archaeology, take your pick, they're all based on the globe model. And on top of that, all the media that you absorb, and I'm not going to necessarily condemn, you know, all the science fiction movies out there. There's some wonderful fantasy tales, but take the big ones, you know, the big franchises like Star Trek and Star Wars and Battlestar Galactica and anything that goes in space, that we have put out a lot of space movies. Those fill in the gaps where science doesn't. And so when it comes to somebody, you know, that believes that they're interpreting whatever Bible it is in that context, it's like, well, yeah, of course I believe the Bible is true, or again, whatever Bible it is. But at the same time, I've been conditioned for, you know, however old you are, let's say it's 20 years. 20 years is a huge amount of time. I mean, it took me 9 months to break out of this. Now, granted, I didn't have as much material as other people do. And, yeah, people will get, you know, enraged. And I've seen, how should I put this? It's not just in the religious world either. It's in the conspiracy world. Whereas I wasn't kidding when I opened up, I think, my first minute or two of the clues, which I said, look, I know people that full on believe that all the royals in every royal family in the world are lizard people, you know, they're reptilian, you know, shapeshifter types. But if I go, and they believe this, they'll tell me this straight to my face, but I will come to them and I'll say two words. I'll say, you know what, flat earth. They will look at me, roll their eyes and say, get out of here. I didn't want to hear this. It is the ultimate open-minded test, but it's not because you're closed-minded. It's just because you've been conditioned. I get it. You know, the polarization, and yes, in the churches I've seen it too. There's some people. In fact, what is it? Isaiah. Is that 40:22 or the whole, you know, he who sits upon the circle of the earth. There's two people, you know, two people in the same church will look at that. One will say, well, it's the circle. It's got to be a globe. And the other one will say, well, it's a circle. It's got to be a flat plane. And, you know, they'll get really, really heated and polarized. And the other thing I got to bring up is the other reason why it is so polarizing and why people get so angry, and you'll see it in the forums. I mean, if you haven't seen it already, people get really, really angry, is because it is the only conspiracy you can't run away from. You can't hide from this thing. You know, if you don't want to look into, you know, your garden variety conspiracies, like JFK, for example, we'll just use JFK. If you don't want to look at JFK, you don't have to. That secret is buried in the desert somewhere. No one's ever going to find out, you know, to the last days what exactly happened. The average person is not going to know what happened at JFK. And you don't have to care. Even World Trade Center, you don't have to care. I mean, yeah, if you lived in New York, you might have a stake in it. But, you know, the West Coast, a lot of people think, yeah, we've heard of it. And now, you know, it's been enough years. There are kids growing up, like, they have no idea what happened. The point is that the whole flat earth and closed world theory is something that is, not only can you not run away from it, it's something you've been living your entire life, it's something that's underneath your feet, and it's a massive trick that was pulled on you. There's an old Mark Twain saying, which is, people would rather believe a lie than to believe they've been lied to. And this one goes so long that, you know, the first response is always denial. And it's kind of like, I'll use the Matrix reference, so I'm trying not to steal too much from them, which was when Neo first found out about the Matrix, for real. Of course, he heard about it, but when he finally got it, he totally went into denial. It's like he just started swinging and didn't, you know, was just mad at everybody and yelling at everybody. And that's where I run into a lot of people. Now, it doesn't last forever. You know, the denial and anger doesn't last forever, but you understand there's a lot, you know, people have to go through it. I went through it. I banged, literally banging my head on the keyboard going, this cannot be, there's no way I could have missed this. I consider myself a very good creative problem solver. And, you know, it's the ultimate street magic trick. I love it.
Yeah, amen to that. You know, it's kind of funny. Part of my research was because I got some emails, et cetera. You know, of course, there's the naysayers, you know, you're a shill, you're a Jew, you're a CIA operative, you know, the whole gamut. And I've told people, I said, you know, the scripture tells us to keep an open mind.
Yeah.
You know, Thessalonians, it says to accept all things and keep that which is good. My interpretation of that is what's good matches up with the prophets, the teachings of Christ, logic, empirical evidence, Occam's razor. I mean, you can go on and on and on. That's what defines good. As my father used to tell me all the time, you cannot argue with success. In other words, not necessarily the billionaires that have bilked us through the phony, baloney, Babylonian money system, but success in the sense of somebody that's, exemplifies the attributes of Christ and has a lot of friends and does good works and tries to promote the things that Christ promoted. So when I came to this, and it was the same way as you, it was brought to my attention. To be honest with you, I'm a student pilot. I never really thought about it while I was up in the air, like so many other people. Just never thought about it. Even though I lived in Michigan where I could see Chicago across Lake Erie, I've actually experienced that many, many times. It just never dawned on me. But after being presented with this idea, and again, I looked at it more in a way as to debunk it. I thought, this is ridiculous. We have satellites, we have spaceships, we got NASA, we got all this stuff. But I listened to probably at least four of your interviews. I listened to several of Eric DeBay's and several of Rob Skiba's. And I got to tell you, I know you guys have some differences of opinion and maybe even some personality issues at times. But, I mean, you three guys present so much evidence and so much, even not so much evidence, but even just like 9/11. I mean, everybody laughed when I said back in 2001 that 9/11 was an inside job. I had a lot of people in my own family thought I was crazy, but here we are 15 years later, and if you still think 9/11 happened the way the government says, everybody realizes that you're pretty much mentally deficient. But they laughed then, and so I look at it the same way with this new information. You're right, we're brainwashed. Anytime you give an automatic response to something without searching the matter out, without hearing the matter out, that is a sign of brainwashing, and it is also a violation of Scripture. Wouldn't you agree?
Oh, yeah. I can't get, because complete brainwashing is so new to people, they don't realize that it's happened. That's the whole point of brainwashing. The most effective brainwashing is you don't know. I can't condemn people too much. I just, I try to tell them, look, be the example you were supposed to be. Don't fall into the trap. And I know it's easier said than done, and who knows? You know, I may have, in their shoes, I may have done the same thing, but I know I agree with you.
Yeah, it's amazing. And here again, I wanted to bring this to people's attention because I've got a lot of people who have contacted me, and some of them have been listeners for many years, and their basic thing was, what difference does it make? Well, here's why it's important to me. First of all, we're supposed to be all about the truth. But here's the biggest reason. This globe theory that they push on us, remember, truth stands on its own, but it takes the force of government to promote a lie. This global lie separates us from the Father. It negates Scripture. It negates the idea that we're special. It negates the idea that we have a Creator who put us on a garden, which is the Hebrew word means a protected area. That's where we get the word garden from. The Hebrew word, it means a protected area. We put a fence around our garden to protect it from wild animals. He put a firmament over the earth to protect us from what's out there. And yet, I mean, look at everything they're trying to tell us now. We should worry about asteroids. We should worry about comets. We should worry about extraterrestrials. We should worry about Planet X. All these things are unprovable to the average man. And so to me, it fits in that category. It is more brainwashing to separate us from Father.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. It is it's the ultimate religious disconnect, which is why, and I dodged this issue for quite a while because I knew it was very touchy when I was building the clues, and then finally, I was getting emails every single hour saying people are saying you've got to address the question of God, and does this prove God? And you're absolutely right. It is, and that's why I named the clue Hiding God. And when I was talking about it, I was like, this is the ultimate science punch in the face for science, and they know it. When you have science preaching their doctrine for 500 years, and you know full well, they've been hitting all the religious houses, they've been hitting them over the head with these textbooks for years and years. And for the most part, they've been not necessarily winning, but they've been pushing people back. And now all of a sudden they have this choice. It's like, okay, do we tell people the truth? Do we tell them that God actually exists? And, there's a handprint of God right over here. And, here's the ultimate proof of intelligent design. Do we give religion this leverage, this power over science? And there's no way science was ever going to go for that. There's such a huge, I don't even know if it's a hatred. It's just this massive seething animosity between science and religion. And no, it was unfortunate because they were the ones that figured it out first, of course. And once they did, they were the. But I agree with everything you're saying there. It is, in my opinion, I won't dance around it too much here. It is, the ultimate sign, proof of God. Because yes, if it is an enclosed structure, and it was created, it's a creator, and that takes away all this little, I look, this tiny little rock floating through space that is so vast, we don't even have the verbiage to display the numbers accurately. And in truth, the world is much more intimate, it functions on amazing efficiency levels, and honestly, the design is much better as a flat, enclosed, firmament-based world than it is a globe. And that was one of the things that got me. It brought me back to spirituality. I had been, away from that for years, heavily technology based, and this brought me back.
Yeah, and again, that's exactly why I think it's important. And I find it amazing that there are believers who are so abject in their disapproval. And even to the point of calling people names and, behavior I find completely counter to what our Messiah told us to do, especially as brothers. Everything in Scripture condemns those that ridicule, condemns those that denounce or cause a wedge between brothers over issues. Now, here's the thing. I will agree with people that say, in a sense, what difference does it make? We're here. Let's be about the business of waking people up to these the New World Order and all that. Okay, I agree with all that, but we've been doing that. I know I've been doing that for nearly 30 years, okay? So the watchmen on the wall have been screaming about the New World Order and all this other stuff for decades. And guess what? It still marches on. The sheep are still basically out in the pasture fields munching on hay. The shepherds are pretty much liars, the mainstream ones are anyway. Okay, guys, we got that. Now, here is something I consider extremely significant in that it exposes the level that these people in control right now will go to perpetuate a lie to separate us from the power of our Heavenly Father. So, to me, this is much more critical than people think because of what you just said. If we're on a plane that's got a protective dome, exactly as Scripture says, and there is no proof, NASA and all the rest of them don't give proof. They give CGI images and all this stuff, and people take that to be proof. No, it's not proof. It's computer-generated. It's paintings and artist conceptions. It's basically a stage production.
Yes.
So you know, that's why I find this so important. You know, every person I know of personally, and it's quite a few, but every person I know personally who has come to at least research and entertain that this is a correct theory feels a closer relationship to Father, not worse. And I've had quite a few people that have had no interest in the Bible, no interest in talking about religion, but when they come to realize that, oh, wait a minute, NASA is lying to us and we're on an enclosed plane, wait a minute, that means there's a creator. I've seen that happen far more than people say, well, you're just a retard. If you don't think we live on a ball, I'm not going to listen to you. Do you see what I mean? I've had far more positive responses than I have negative.
Oh, yeah. Same here. I've had wonderful letters. You know, you can hear the tears in people's eyes, because if you believe this, you know, it's an all or nothing deal, which is why I always laugh when people say, oh, I'm on the fence about it. It's like, no, nobody's on the fence about this thing. You either buy it or you don't, because if you buy it, then there is God, you know, there is the creator, and we, you know, which is why I told people, and I'm kind of jumping ahead here, we're, you know, we are all accountable for our actions. That's why, you know, when I got to, you know, one of the end clues, when I was looking at that story about, you know, if people haven't watched the clues yet, how the that reporter from England interviewed the Apollo astronauts, and just as sort of like, I don't even know if it was a gag, but he asked him, because he was pretty sure the moon missions, the American space program, was faked, and he was trying to trip them up, so he brought a Bible with him, and he said, you know, swear on the Bible that you didn't, that you went to the moon, and no one would touch it, right? They treated it literally like it was made of radiation. And I go, why would, it bugged me, because I'd seen that documentary years ago, it was back in 2004, I was going, why would they care? It's like, you know, people lie under oath all the time, it's called perjury, we have an extensive legal system, you know, that deals with stuff like that, so why would they care? In fact, if they're not in court, why would they not lie in the Bible? It's because, well, if you know, if you absolutely know, which is why they try to tell as few people as possible now, then it means you are accountable for your actions. And are you really going to roll those dice? It's one thing to lie if you're unsure about, you know, the presence of God. It's a whole other thing, though, if you know. You know, if you know, of course, you know, you're not guaranteeing that a lightning bolt will come down and strike you down if you do lie. But are you going to take that chance? And I saw that in the astronauts. You know, they weren't, you know, it wasn't even the Bible itself. It was swearing under the canopy of God. You know, there didn't even have to be a book. It didn't have to be there, which is why I kind of joked, you know, that it might as well been a piece of wood. It didn't make any difference. It was God himself. It wasn't the word. So, that was very, very interesting. And let me throw one more thing out there, because we may be, maybe some people listening to this, and I don't know if you've covered this in other shows, but when you, because you said, well, you know, NASA shows us CGI and all this stuff. It's like, look, when I went looking for this, I immediately tried to find the evidence. Like anybody, you know, it's like, well, we obviously have these volumes and volumes of evidence that's out there. So all I have to do is go to NASA archives and find it. And the more I looked in the NASA archives, I realized how empty and thin it was. You know, it should be, you know, since the 1950s, there should be just truckloads of evidence. And there wasn't. People that want to look this up, you know, this is easy stuff. This is not secret information. You can Google any of this. You know, look up pictures of the Earth from space. There was only one taken from 1972 until the summer of last year. That was supposedly from Apollo 18. Showed the bottom part of Africa and all of Antarctica. We all know this picture very, very well. There are no, up until last year, there was no picture, literally, no movie of the Earth rotating on its axis from space. There still is no movie of any object. I don't care if it's the Americans, the Russians, Japanese, Europeans, doesn't make any difference. There's no movie of a camera on a rocket leaving orbit Earth, you know, or coming back to Earth. There's no camera that does that. There's no movie of any astronaut holding a camera and turning at 180 degrees or further around. That's just turning around with the camera running. And it's from Apollo all the way, you know, through anything. No exterior shot. And you can say, well, no, interior shot, ISS, that doesn't count. I'm talking exterior shot. Interior, you can do anything you want. If I want to shoot an interior shot, I mean, Hollywood, we fake space stuff all the time. An interior, that's not hard. There's even, I'll go so far as that there's not even a movie of an astronaut with a GoPro camera on his helmet opening up an airlock and walking outside the spacecraft, you know, with it, you know, from his point of view. There's none of this stuff. And people say, well, that doesn't prove flat Earth. I was going, well, no, it doesn't. But statistically speaking, it really, really screams that whatever the shape the Earth is, they don't want to show you. They really going out of their way to not show you what our world looks like. And if it's not a globe, then what is it? And, you know, everything else that we've looked at points that it is, you know, the old school, Old Testament firmament-based world. And, again, you know, anyone can look this up. So I know, you know, we're jumping around, you know, people say, oh, no, you can trust NASA. It's like, well, I used to think that, too. You know, just because they wear white and don't carry guns and smile for the camera, don't think for a second that they're not part of the system. You know, they are a Department of Defense military wing of the United States government based on weapons technology. You know, their entire group is based on, you know, intercontinental ballistic missile technology. But they put on this face, you know, and we've tied them to, like, Starfleet. You know, they might as well be Starfleet to us. You know, they're a benign organization that can do no wrong, and they release stories, all fun stories all the time. But ask yourself this, what have they really done in the last, 30 years? Nothing. Most Americans don't even know the space shuttle program's been canceled for years now. We don't even have a space shuttle program. Oh, yeah, we've got the ISS, whatever. There's nothing happening up there. The Mars program has been delayed and delayed and delayed and delayed. No one's going to Mars. They are never going to send a manned mission to Mars. Now, if you want to send a Mars rover up to Mars, that's fine. Yeah, even though we all know full well, you may know this, look, when a car battery dies, it dies, right? You can't bring it back to life. No jumper cable in the world can bring a car battery to life. The Mars rover battery should have died years ago. In fact, like 6 or 7 years ago. And they decided, like a television show that won't die, they decided just to keep it running. It's like, oh, yeah, we're still taking pictures. It's like, really? You're taking pictures on Mars with technology that should have died? Statistically speaking, again, there's no way that thing should run. But anyway, the point is, I'll end. I know I'm going off on a rant here. Is that the Mars mission won't happen because of the simple fact that, and the reason why we're even talking about this right now, is the detection ability of the average person for the internet has increased by orders of magnitude. The average person now can analyze videos and pictures and audio and can compare with people all in different countries all over the place things that they didn't have the access to before. You know, it took high-speed internet and social media to do this. So imagine how quick it was. It took a little while, but the moon mission, the Apollo program, the American space program was dissected almost immediately and now has aged so badly that it's ridiculous. So imagine trying to fake a Mars program, because the reason why it is hard is because in order to fake it, you get to treat it like a movie production. And the reason why there are websites like moviemistakes.com and moviebloopers.com is because movies, for cost efficiency in most cases, are shot out of sequence. If you're going to shoot a whole, you know, you're going to take every desert scene and you're going to shoot it at the same time, you know, to save money. You're not going to just go back and forth depending on the script. So the Mars mission will have to be shot like a movie. And I don't care how much money you have, there's no way you can get it done that quickly and not make a mistake. You just can't, it can't be done. And if you have one mistake that shows up on the internet that gets passed around on social media, that's it. The whole thing gets blown wide open. I was not kidding when I'm never kidding when it comes to this, but when somebody, if I would work for the government, for example, and they came to me with a folder and said, oh yeah, by the way, you're going to be heading up the fake Mars program, and you have an unlimited budget, you have access to the best talent in Hollywood as far as special effects and technical guys, I'd say, you're out of your mind. I can't do it. It cannot be done. The internet, all it takes is one nerd at 3 o'clock in the morning in the middle of Nebraska to find one frame that's out of sync, and that's it. The whole thing's blown. Look up moviemistakes.com. It doesn't matter how much money you spend on movies, you're gonna make mistakes. And so, yeah, that's where NASA is in trouble. So now they're trying to wind it down. You know, they're selling the ISS program. They're talking. All they're doing is talking now. It's like they're releasing stories because of what we're talking about right now. They're releasing stories. It used to be every month and it was every 2 weeks. Now it's every day. Just making up stuff. It's like, oh, this black hole looks like this. Oh, look what's going on. Pluto. Here's what's happening. It's Saturn. Oh, there could be a new meteor shower and asteroids and so on and so on. It doesn't matter, and you're thinking, why would they release the stories? Because the subtext underneath those stories is always the same. So you see a funny shape on the top of Saturn. You're seeing this from a globe. Oh, look, our probe just went by Pluto from a globe. Everything comes back. It doesn't matter even if you believe the story, or if you care, if even you look for more than 5 seconds of the story. It's that you would, it's a space reinforcement story, meaning space is out there, you're on a globe. That's it. That's all they're doing right now, and they're holding on by their fingernails, and it's running. They're running out of time. So sorry, that's my rant.
Hey, that's a good rant. and by the way, I want to say congratulations for a complete CIA paid show. You do one hell of a good job.
Thank you, thank you. I thought it, I should address that because I get that every once in a while. In fact, I saw it. What interview did I do that on? It was very recently because I was asked, to address it, and it's like, look, I don't blame you. I don't blame people for, you know, especially in the community, for not trusting me on certain things. The things that have come my way because of this, I think it's everything's for a reason, and I call it providence. But yes, I have not solicited any interviews. The book thing that came my way, they called me. I didn't call anybody. The apps that were done, the websites, the podcasts, and everything else that's coming down the road. And people said, well, it's because you're CIA and you're part of the system and it's just set up and it's scripted. It's like, no, it's because I put my phone number and my email address and my real name on things. That's the biggest reason. I firmly believe that now. Of course, the other stuff, I do think it's providence. But I do make it easy for people to find me if they want to talk about this. And, I don't mind being the tip of the spear when it comes to this. I don't, because... for whatever reason, if you want to say I was shoulder tapped to get this thing going, I fully embrace it. This, the whole Flat Earth movement, or now it's called an awakening, it started kind of in the middle of 2014, but there were guys who were talking about it before then. You know, I've got to give credit to Matt Boylan. You know, he was one of the guys that when I looked at this thing, the stories that I was trying to debunk, and he'd been talking about it for years, and he was really sticking to one point, which was photo or painting. He was just beating on that drum. And it was, and the other people were, it was, the message was coming in a little staticky. All I really did was I created, for lack of a better word, the Dummy's Guide to Flat Earth. And, you know, I just turned the radio station, you know, dial just a little bit. The signal came in clearer, and then people got it. I didn't invent the whole Flat Earth concept. That's been around forever, you know. Literally, the Flat Earth concept was there long before the whole globe concept came into being. And, that's kind of what, but yeah, as far as being a shill goes, yeah, I'd be the greatest shill of all time and the worst shill of all time. But because if I'm trying to steer it away from people, I don't, you know, I love that people will call me that sometimes, like, but they won't tell me what my agenda is or even what I'm working for. So I can tell you, I'm not working for anybody. It's the last thing I ever thought I was going
to do. Well, Mark, you must be with CIA because your evidence that you put forth brings us closer to the Heavenly Father as a creator. So obviously you're CIA.
Because the government has a vested interest in destroying their own scientific institutions and letting religion take center stage again. No, of course not. I've never been part of any sort of weird organization, group, foreign or domestic. It is strictly, and I look, the label that was slapped on there, most of it was from the guys that were just angry. I hate to use this because it's going to sound weird, but it's kind of like the new girl in school type of thing, where, you know, the other guys think they got a pretty good idea and they know their place and their status, and I come in, it's like, who does she think she is? You know, it's like, I wasn't trying to do anything. All I was this thing out there. I mean, actually, I did have some confidence, but I thought I missed something. Where if you've ever taken a test and you knew you aced it, but before turning it in, you've got that nagging feeling. It's like, man, did I ace it? Did I actually ace it, or did I miss something? And I thought I missed something. I did, but I considered myself a good enough problem solver that it's like, okay, if I missed something, it must have been, you know, something so small but so vital. But I didn't. I didn't miss anything. The people that have come forward, again, the subject matter experts on this, all the pilots and the engineers and the surveyors and all the members from the armed forces, they've all corroborated. Everybody's, you know, and not only have none of them recanted their stories, and I've done, I think, 17 of them now, but nobody's come out against them. And I've left it wide open. I said, look, if anyone wants to, you know, we invite debate all the time, but they can't because there's too many questions they can't answer, which is why the science community is running from this thing. They've almost, you know, I've seen emails between different academics where they're telling each other, it's like, look, don't get in the middle of this. Do not talk about this because no one, you know, you don't want to be the scientist that goes down. When this thing gets out there, because the flat earth community, unfortunately, has so much dissension in the ranks, this is coming back to your shill thing, that they don't want to, you know, they're kind of like, I'll use the Roman army analogy, you know, the Roman army is encamped somewhere waiting for the next war, you know, their next opponent, and they're getting restless and hungry. And so they're turning on each other in some cases, you know, the camps, you know, they're starting to square off, and it's because science will not, of course, Neil deGrasse Tyson went on national television and did his little thing, you know, saying that flat earth is possibly a danger to democracy and all this other stuff, and he kind of turned it into something humorous, but they know, from their point of view, yeah. They know it's trouble. They know the scientific communities, and because I should probably address this real quick, which is people. I'll get this question at least once a week, which is why does it matter? Why does it matter whether the Earth is round or if it's flat? And sometimes people ask that because it's too big for them, and they don't know what to deal with it. And it's like, okay, it doesn't matter until the day it does. Meaning. When it does, you know, if it actually came out in mainstream, it actually, you know, this actually happens. Think of the massive implications right off the bat, and I'll do them real quick. The first is from an academic standpoint. Every major university in every country who has an astrophysics and astronomy department, those departments literally go away overnight. They close their doors. Those people don't come back to work the next day. All the remaining sciences, you know, geology, hydrology, archaeology, biology, anything with an ology next to it, they have to be rebuilt from the ground up. They still survive, but they have to, all those textbooks, they'll get thrown away, you know, because they have to be altered so badly. And then you know, the economic implications. First of all, you know what I said about, you know, doing things malicious. I will not do anything malicious to anyone and ever again because, you know, I fully believe that we are being watched. There's someone looking over our shoulders. You know, apply that to an entire army, a real army. You know, if you're firing cannons at somebody across a hill, are you really going to keep firing those cannons? You know, and if that's the case, if your armies stand down, then what happens to all those companies that build the weapons for these armies? You know, the massive military contractors and subcontractors. The economic shockwaves would be immense. And then last but not least, all the major, you know, religious houses, you know, the big five that control 80% of the population, Judaism, Hinduism, Buddhism, Islam, and Christianity, they all get proof of intelligent design simultaneously. And science is reeling. If science is a boxer in a ring, they are on the ropes because simple questions now get posed to science. One is, well, if you were wrong about that, what else are you wrong about, right? And then the flip side to religion is like, wow, religion was right about that all along. What else are they right about? It's a massive paradigm shift, and it changes everything, you know. And then people say, well, I still got to go to my crappy job in the morning. It's like, yeah, but over the next week or so, the attitude of that job and everything else around it will change, because that's all anyone's going to talk about. You know, all your major newspapers and television stations and all your major media things, that's all, that's the only topic they're going to talk about. You know, sermons. every can you imagine every, that following Sunday, you know, every church everywhere, that's going to be the lead. You know, what does it mean? What does it mean, and how does it affect you? Everybody's, you know, consciousness changes. And don't think you can avoid it. You know, you go to a dinner party, you go to a bar, you go to anything, you go to a freaking shopping mall. That's all any, it's going to be on anybody's mind. You're going to see people who are literally going to be standing in the middle of the street staring up at the sky and trying to figure out where they are and what their life means. They're going to have to reevaluate their life. And most, I think, will be able to handle it. Of course, there'll be some people, you know, for example, again, I know I'm going off on this whole rant here, but you're thinking, well, who wouldn't be able to handle it? Well, people that have done a lot of bad things in their life. You know, we'll use the most extreme. Let's say a contract killer, right? Guy that did nothing but hit, you know, kill people for the mob. What's that guy going to do? You know, he's going to walk outside and go, oh, man. This whole thing, it's like I used to, you know, like to brush it off. Well, it's like there's no God anyway, so, you know, fine, I can kill people for a living. It's like, oh, man, what do you do now? You know, it's an interesting problem. It opens up so many question lines and so many thought lines. And it's so intriguing for me, which is why, you know, it sounds like I'm super somewhat manic about it. It's because when you get into this, you know, I've seen people just, you know, they'll lose themselves for weeks. You know, they get into it, and that's all that's on their mind. It's, you know, they go, 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 go. You know, flat earth, every day asks for flat earth, and then, you know, some of them get burned out, and other people, you know, they're in it for the long haul. But it's you know, I don't regret it for a second so far.
Yeah, excellent. Well, case in point, the communist news network, CNN, just the other day said that everybody that follows 9/11 truth is mentally ill. So the mainstream media is in bed with these people in government and these scientists. So, but here's the good news. Most people don't believe the mainstream media anymore. I mean, poll after poll after poll shows that they find them to be just as much a liar as the average person from the government and the average person from NASA. They're all lying. But anyway, we're mentally ill because we question 9/11, and they can't answer. See, that's the thing. They can't answer the questions. Now, the other thing that came to my mind I wanted to ask you, you mentioned that it seems that recently there's a great awakening, and I've seen that too, not just in this area of the enclosed earth. But there's a great awakening to the lies and the deceptions that we've been have been foisted upon us. Do you think, and this is a hypothetical question here, do you think it has anything to do with the fact that there is so little trust in what we used to believe in, namely mainstream media, government, etc., and we the people have taken on the mantle of investigative journalists at this time? Do you think that has anything to do with it?
Yeah, because the average person now can create so much of their own media, and that media can get quite a bit of exposure. You know, look at what YouTube has done, and I know they've tried to control YouTube to a certain degree, but they really failed with it, because how do you control an online forum of people that have basically become their own documentary creators? The mainstream is the mainstream media has, of course, they've been run, they've been controlled for a number of years now. They haven't been controlled necessarily since the beginning, but it's gotten a lot more honed to where even random stories, you know, I don't believe, we've all seen, if you haven't seen already, you know, look up the even local news gets fed from the Associated Press now, to where they read the same script, you know, in every city in the country when it comes to a lot of generic stories. But yeah, you're absolutely right. The mainstream media has to, also another reason why it's so tough for anybody to break out. It's like, you know, it's like, why aren't there more whistleblowers to talk about this and that? And we'll use the flat earth thing as a perfect example. It's like, well, why wouldn't, you know, if somebody from NASA knew about this, wouldn't they come forward? I go, who are they going to come forward to? But the mainstream media, the big three, of course, you know, Fox News, NBC News, and CNN, they're locked down tighter than a drum. You can't get the story that far. It's never going to go national. But your point about the World Trade Center, that's a great example, which is, of course they're going to spread that. It's like, oh, you know, 9/11 truthers, 9/11 truthers. It's like, I think they're shooting themselves in the foot because they're doing the same thing local with Flat Earth, which is, you see it on CNN, but at the same time, if you go on the internet, and because of CNN, you know, you've heard Anderson Cooper say it, then, and you type in 9/11 truth, depending on where you type it in, you may get to one of, I don't know, thousands and thousands of 9/11 truth videos, and you're going to find some good stuff. And 9/11, I try to boil down most conspiracies into usually one sentence, and that is, when it comes to 9/11, it's like, okay, why did Building 7 fall? Period. And that's it. That's all you have to look into. And once you start going down that rabbit hole, you're done. But all the others, even the small ones, the regional ones, you know, like Sandy Hook or Boston bombing, you know, I took it for face value. Everyone looks at it, it's like, well, you know, if the mainstream news reports it, it must be true. And I still know, I have family members that believe that everything that is on the news is true. And then you come back and say, well, is everything on the internet true? And they go, well, no, of course not. Like, well, what's the difference? You know, they're both controlled to a certain degree, but at least the internet has the chance of people coming out and saying true things, which you're right. We've got now, we become our own journalists, and that is part of the big reason, is because that end, of course, the millennials and the new group that's coming out, which is I love their new title. It used to be what Gen Y, but it's they're now called iGen. I think that one's going to stick, which is they're watching less and less television because television is too slow. Even with all the channels and all the recording ability that you have on television now, it's not as interactive and it doesn't give you as much data as quickly as the internet does. You know, you combine, you know, how can television stand up to the combination of Facebook and YouTube and Twitter and all these other things, you know, that go from micro to macro? It's fascinating. But yeah, that's why part of the reason it's happening. People are paying more attention to stuff. And I know people, you know, the mainstream is like, well, YouTube. It's like, what are you talking about? Google owns YouTube. You know, YouTube is the video depository out there. It's like, why would anyone look down on YouTube? It is a they say that it's like, well, YouTube videos. So it's like you talk to every mainstream, anybody who's anybody has YouTube videos now. NBC News runs a YouTube feed. Fox News runs a YouTube feed, it's amazing. But they have to run it now against other people that can come out of nowhere and create wonderful, wonderful pieces based on truth.
Right? Amen. So yeah. Do you agree then that this could be the period of time that the prophets told us about, when there would be a, quote, increase in knowledge or truth, and the verse that talks about that all the things that have been hidden will become made known? It sort of fits with what's happening, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does. It is, you know, I was wondering as I was going through this, why now? That's one of the other questions that comes out. It's like, why now? Why is all of a sudden? Because you also got to remember that the whole Flat Earth concept, it is not being repressed. I mean, yeah, there's some token fights here and there, but coming from a technology base, which I do, you know, I know how easy it is to shut down stuff. So, for example, when you're in YouTube, and because I get a lot of people that will tell me this, it's like, oh yeah, I was just in YouTube and I was looking up something on JFK, and something was recommended to me on the right side of the screen, and it happened to be Flat Earth. Like, why would that ever be allowed to happen? If you want to suppress this, you go into YouTube. It's a simple coding thing, and you say anything that has Flat Earth in the title, you don't recommend to anybody. Same thing with Google. I mean, we've even changed the Google search priorities right now. If you go into any search engine, go into Google though, and type in Earth is, or the Earth is, and see what shows up. It will always show up at the top of the list now. The Earth is flat. That wasn't there even 6 months ago, I don't think. That all of a sudden changed. It was, you know, before it was like the Earth is round, the Earth is sphere, the Earth was built by God. But now it is the Earth is flat. It is amazing to see how far this has come. And I actually forgot the first part of what you were asking there. Oh yeah. Is this the time? Oh, why is this the time? Because I initially thought that all you had to do was have the internet to get this thing ready. You know, to get to the last stage, what I call, you know, Act Three. But now I know that's not true, because it wasn't just internet; it was high speed internet, and it was high speed internet for everybody. And then it was finally social media. Social media had to get into play to where you had high-speed internet coupled with systems that could alert everyone almost instantaneously, to where if an event happened, no matter where it happened, just about anywhere, anybody in the world could have access to it in less than 30 minutes. Usually, you know, by the time, you know, it broadcasts around, you know, if they're, you know, I'm even being generous with 30 minutes, probably less than that, probably 10. But that's what it is. So now you can create, you know, some sort of world event or whatever happens, everyone will know all over everywhere it simultaneously. And that's where I think, and that just finally happened just recently. I mean, you know, social media has now gotten to the point where it's about as refined as it's going to get, in my opinion. Now we're just kind of creating new little things, but all the staples are there. So, you know, people say, why now? Why 2015? Why did this thing start coming out? It's like, well, because apparently our technology finally caught up to where it needed to be. Now, do the powers that be, the authority, the sinister forces, do they have stake in this? Yes, they do. Are they going to try to turn this into a certain direction? Yes, I do. I do think that. But to what direction? Still up in the air. Because, you know, if you do it right, you could reduce the conflict quite a bit and turn it into a new golden age. You do it wrong, or you go down a dark path with this thing, and you know, then it goes and comes into the whole Georgia Guidestones category, and it could get ugly in a hurry. So, you know, I'm trying to stay optimistic and say, you know, glass half full, but that's where I think we are now.
Well, the scriptures tell us that the Father is laughing in derision at the plans of these wicked people. And
yeah.
It also says that in the end, all that they have planned to do to us will be turned over back on them double. So hallelujah
yeah.
for that. There is a Father in heaven watching over his children, and they will not succeed. Yes, you're right. They have much evil planned. They don't like the truth being exposed. However, our Father in heaven has the upper hand, and he said it would at the end of the age, where I think we are, that this would happen. A couple notes I jotted down while you were talking. The scripture says the Spirit testifies to the truth. That's one of the reasons why I think this is resonating with people right now. Spiritual people, It literally does. It vibrates or rings true when you hear things like this. So 9/11, I knew right away. The very first time I saw a picture or heard the voice of Bill Clinton, I knew he was evil. That was it. That's the very first picture and voice of Barack Obama. I knew he was evil. I told people that. I said, these people are evil. Oh, Dan, you're crazy. He's new on the scene. How can you say that? I said, I don't know how I can say it. I'm just telling you. When it's all said and done, these people are evil. And I don't know, I feel vindicated. But anyway, one of the things I wanted to bring up during this discussion, since there are many, many people are going to be listening to this broadcast, part of the problem that I find, well, actually there's two. Most of the people that object to the enclosed earth movement or theory are people who are highly invested with either their written material or their speaking material with scare porn about Planet X, asteroids, extraterrestrials, all the things the government wants us to be constantly in fear about. They're heavily invested in that, so that if this is true, now, you know what I'm saying, they end up with egg in their face. That's one of the things. The other part is that they equate what you and Rob and Eric are teaching to be the ridiculous thing that was put out when the Globus first started, when they used to, just like they taught me in grade school. Oh, the ancients used to think that if you sailed a ship off in a certain direction, you fell off the edge of the earth. Well, that's not really true, but that's what they taught. they taught a totally ridiculous theory that actually intelligent people thought you would sail off the edge of the table, just like the Earth was a table. They don't understand that that's not what we're talking about. We're talking about a very special enclosure with the ice ring. There is no way you could sail off the edge. Does that make sense that they're confusing this ridiculous thing that was taught years and years ago versus what we're actually teaching today?
Yeah. The old tricks are the best tricks, and it's amazing how many people I will hear that will bring up the ship thing. And that is an old, you know, story they used to say. It's like, well, you know, and of course it goes back to the days when, you know, a ship would leave a harbor, you know, because 95%, I think, or most of our, I don't know, 87%, 89% of our civilization lives next to some sort of body of water, where if a ship goes out far enough, it will disappear. And they think that it goes hull first and they only see the mass, but the truth is it's just going line of sight perspective and it's just getting smaller and smaller and smaller until finally it just disappears. But the human eyesight only without any aids going goes about 3 miles. And what we're learning now is, and it's the end, what you're saying there is the reinforcement's amazing. That story still carries so much weight today. It's like either, oh, we'll sail off the edge or, it's odd, or they'll do it the other way. It's obvious it's a curve because we see ships disappear in the distance, and they always go hull first. It's like, really? Have you really seen that? Because what we've now know is, especially the camera was really, remember what I said about the detection technology of just the world, and what's really changed in the last 5-10 years is cameras, which is computer technology. Now you can fit massive amounts of processing power into a camera. And with that, you can do fun things like have an amazing zoom capability. So if you look up the, I don't know, it's really endorsing it, it's just one that people are picking. It's the Coolpix 900, which is like a 70 power zoom, which is insane amounts of zoom. And you think, well, what do you do with that? It's like, okay, you see a ship. You let that sucker go away, and you can't see it anymore. Like, and you can take your time. You know, let it sail away, you know, to where it's gone in the distance, and you wait another hour, and it's still gone. You know, it's gone even further. You take that camera, and it's a clear enough day, you know, not a lot of waves or anything. You can zoom in, and you can bring that. You can now see that ship again. It's there again. It's like, wait a minute, how's that? You're thinking, what does that do? It's like, well, you got to remember that if, and I'm going to throw some math out there for people. Here's the easy test, and I did not talk about this in the clues, which is the curvature of the Earth is supposedly 8 inches per mile squared, which means 8 inches times every mile times itself. So it's 2 miles, it's 2 times 2, which is 4 times 8 is 32 inches. 3 times 3 is 9, times 8 is 72 inches. And what that means is that should be that much curvature. So if a boat is out 20 miles, then it should be 20 times 20 times 8 inches. That boat is, and you can divide it by feet, however you want, that boat should be on the other side of the hill. So how can we see it? And they'll say, well, it's an illusion or it's a refraction. It's like, really? Because we can see this with just about anything. Now, forget about boats. You can see stationary objects. In fact, that's one of the challenges I'm going to be putting forward to scientists. We're going to be kind of blindsiding them with it, which is, find me an object across a body of water that we can't see. Meaning, you know, if you have a lighthouse that's 50 miles away, right? 50 miles away, that's, you know, roughly 1,700 feet of curvature, and that lighthouse is only 200 feet tall, and you're looking at it, and you know, you look across 50 miles, that should be gone. There's nothing you should be able to do to see that lighthouse. It's on the other side of the hill. You can't look through hills. We all know that. If your friend lives in a house on the other side of the hill, it doesn't matter what special spyglass you got, you're not going to be able to see his house. Why can you see that lighthouse over that body of water? You should not be able to see it. And science will say, well, it's refraction, it's all these things. It's like, okay, fine. Tell me why Kansas, the state of Kansas, is technically 99.999% flat, absolutely flat. And that's a massive body of land. Why is that possible? How is that even possible? They'll say, well, it's just a flat piece of land on a globe. Well, really, is it? Because that's a really, really big piece of land. That's just Kansas. What about Nebraska? What about other pieces of land all over the place? We just used Kansas as an example. University did a study some years ago. the old tricks keep popping up, but they keep getting shot down because science can't. I'm still waiting. You know, I'm that's the thing I'm going to be putting out to science, which is find me an object that is a certain distance away that cannot be seen because the curvature of the Earth is there. Find me an object. It should be easy. It should be extremely easy, and it doesn't ever happen. And that's one of the reasons, by the way, you know, flat Earth is getting, you know, that's just one small aspect of it. But it gets so much traction, and nobody's coming out against it. It's like, oh yeah, well, here's a building on, you know, across from, you know, this small, you know, chunk of ocean. It's, you can say, what, 40 miles away or 50 miles away, or whatever, and you can't see it. It's like, no, we've never run into that ever. And so people just keep going out, and it's like, you know, the Hawaiian Islands or the Reunion Islands or the Chicago skyline. They just keep coming up with more and more things that just keeps piling up on our side, and science is answering with nothing, which is why this thing, you know, again, I did a statistics video recently, which is why when this thing started back in the beginning of last year, you know, when you typed flat Earth into YouTube, you got maybe 50,000 hits, you know, 50,000 relevant articles tied to it. You type that in now, it is pushing 7 million. And if you type in Earth is flat, it's 10 million. That brings in the debunkers. And that's the sort of traction this thing is getting. Nothing, no topic out there is as hot as this thing is. And this has all been done without any mainstream media assistance at all. This is like it's been carved out of solid rock. And you know, it's amazing. Imagine what this thing could do with some real exposure. That's just mind-boggling to me.
Well, you know, it brought up a couple things. Let me interject here to go along with what you're saying. How we can be mentally conditioned. I thought of two examples to perfectly illustrate what you're talking about.
Uh-huh.
When people talk about the ark and Noah, how many animals did he put in the ark? Two of every kind. I said, really? What does the book say? Well, it says two of every kind. I said, it says two of all the unclean, seven of the clean animals were taken on board. I said, but how many people know that? Almost none. Why? They don't read their Bibles. They listen to fairy tales. They listen to nursery rhymes. They hear mom and dad. They hear the other ignoramuses talk, and they accept it as fact because they don't investigate anything on their own. Ergo, only two of each animal. But that's not what the book says. Eve ate an apple. It's not what the book says. Not in there. Everybody, you hear people talk about it. And she was seduced by a snake on the ground. No, it's not what the book says, but everybody wants to believe it. And another one is the U.S. Constitution demands separation of church and state. Really? Show me. Show me in the Constitution where separation of church and state is. You'll hear the mainstream media talking heads, the prostitutes in the media talk about it. You'll hear the prostitutes in Washington, D.C. talk about it. And other idiots, but it's not in there. Show me in the Constitution where that's at. It's not in there, okay? But there, how many people believe it? I mean, it's amazing the level of ignorance today. It really is amazing. And another interesting thing I found out recently, and I have to admit, I thought for a long time the Internet was satellite-based. Did you know that? No, it's not. It's not satellite-based at all.
I know that now.
Right. It's all fiber optics.
Yeah.
Around, well, whatever we're on, okay, but let's say that everywhere you have an Internet connection, it's interconnected via fiber optics on terra firma, not bouncing off satellites across the surface of the erats or the ground or the earth or whatever. But I found that interesting. I thought, oh, wait a minute. Now, here's one that even caught me. I thought it was, low-level satellites or whatever. But here again, there was a scientist on a special Discovery-type show, and he was saying, no, it's all fiber optics, folks. And here was another one. Do you remember a few months ago there were eight prominent senior scientists? They had just retired or something like that. And came out and said something to the effect of, sorry, folks, we know what you've been told all these years. However, the data does not support the earth moving through the universe, it supports the celestial bodies, whatever they may be, rotating around a fixed earth. Do you remember reading that?
No, I don't.
I wish I'd have saved it. There were eight prominent scientists, though, had come out and said, well, okay, now we're retired. Probably they're up in age, so they're not worried about being killed or dying because they're up in age. But anyway, they come out and admitted, these eight prominent scientists come out and admitted that all these years the data did not support the government lie that, in fact, we are the center of whatever it is out there. We're the center of it. The data does not support what they're trying to tell us.
It didn't surprise me at all. And it doesn't surprise me it didn't get more mainstream media attention, because it's the biggest story of all time, which is everything that we've built. Again, all the interesting things that happened in the 500 years of science preaching this. I jump around quite a bit, but there was something that I put in my description of my videos now, which was an interesting George Orwell quote, which was, in fact, I could probably read it for you real fast, 1 second. The desktop docs footer, 1 second. Short description. Yeah. So George Orwell, who wrote, 1984, he actually did a paper on this back in the 40s. And it was something about how science convinces people of how things are. And he wrote something, and he goes, because most people, if asked to prove that the Earth is round, would not even bother to produce the rather weak arguments I have outlined above. They would start off by saying that everyone knows the Earth to be round, and if pressed further, would become angry. In a way, Shaw is right. This is a credulous age, and the burden of knowledge which we now have to carry is partly responsible. And he wrote that at the end of 1946, and I thought that was really interesting because NASA wasn't even formed until 1958. So how did everyone know, convinced in their hearts that the Earth was a sphere in 1946? And it's because it was something they were told, and this is kind of what I don't want to have too much time with, but I got to boil some of this down, which is, look, you want the easy way to look at this. It is, there are things we can test today, things you can test right now that we all know to be true. Fire burns, water is wet, you drop something, it falls to the ground. That might as well be gravity, but whatever. It's something that's either pulling or pushing that thing to the ground. Right? These are all things you can test right now. When it comes to the shape of the Earth, that is something you are told. It is not something you can check out for yourself. And by that I mean nobody has a spaceship. And it's like, well, no, I know somebody that knows somebody whose cousin is an astronaut. It's like, fine. There are a total of supposedly 500 people that has ever been to space. And all of them, with the exception of a couple, and I think really those probably roped in, were all military personnel. So it's something you're told. And I know it's easy for us to believe it because we're in the United States, we're Americans, and the American space program we have a lot of pride in. But outside of this country, you wonder why people are more skeptical. It's like, well, the Americans told you that the Earth was a globe. And I'll use a thing. It's like, yeah, God created the sun and the moon, but it was NASA that told you how big it was and how far it was away. So do you have that much faith in a military wing of the United States government? Do you? And people say, well, yes, of course I do, because the United States government would never lie to you ever. We don't have enough time, but full well, just about every – there's a George Carlin line, which I love more than just about any, and I considered him a very, very insightful comedian. But he had this line, he goes, look, I don't have a lot of rules, but one of them toward the top of my list is this. He goes, I don't ever believe anything, and he says this twice, anything that the government tells me, because there's always ulterior motives. Every war that the Americans have ever fought, I'm just picking on the Americans now, every war the Americans have ever fought, every operation, any mass anything that the mainstream media is pushing on you, there is something else behind it. At the very least, it's a half-truth, and most of the time, it's probably a bold-faced lie. So those are the little things. If you don't think they're going to try to lie to you about the big things, you are kidding yourself. And I know ignorance is bliss. But this is, you know, this is the biggest trick, and it's the reason, again, reason why people get so bent out of shape about it is it's like a street magic thing. If you've ever seen a street magician, right? They'll hit you with little things here and there, but they're setting you up for the big one. And by the time you get to the big one, you think you're ready, right? You think you've got it. It's like, no, you can't fool me again. You cannot fool me one more time. And it turns out, you know, the playing card was in your back pocket the entire time. You were set up. You didn't have a chance. I know people get really bent out of shape because they think, oh, you know, I can't be fooled. It's like, no, you were born into this. You had no chance. You were born into this, and your parents before them. There were generations of people that were born into this trick. We believe, I'll use the Truman Show line here, which is we believe the world that is presented to us, which is why I have to reference the M. Night Shyamalan movie, which you take children and you put them anywhere and you raise them in that place, you can make up any reality you want. Even today, which is why the village was such a great thing. If you take children and you create a town in the middle of nowhere and you tell them it's the 1800s, why would they believe any different? If you know, and that applies, we'll circle back to this, which is if you are told, if you and everyone you know are told that you live on a globe, and science believes it because they were told it's on a globe, it's like, not all scientists are in on it, or pilots or anything, none of them know. It's that the foundation, the original foundation was wrong, which was you live on a globe. And so science built all their models based on the globe. And the pilots flying around, they think they're flying around a globe. Why would they think any different? But since the foundation is bad, then everything else that's on top of it is bad. It is wrong. And that's where we are.
Yeah, I agree. I agree, Mark. Excellent points, by the way. I really appreciate you coming on here with us today. If we need to run over a little bit, we can. I only limit it to 90 minutes because most people today just don't have a long attention span.
No, I got you. And we can always do follow-ups, and don't worry about that. I mean, again, you're not going to be able to convince a new person. You're not going to convince in 90 minutes. You just have to put the idea in their head and let them run with it for the next week.
Right. But one of the things I wanted to point out to the listeners and get your input on this, I've watched quite a few of the interviews of people that were, quote, in space, whether it's the space station, Apollo, whatever. And after listening to you, Rob, and Eric, I couldn't help but notice, and why I didn't notice it before, I don't know, but almost every interview, it sticks out like a sore thumb that these guys are either insincere or they're incompetent because they don't have much knowledge. I mean, I was amazed at one of the Apollo commanders. He couldn't answer a single question. He kept deferring the answer to the questions from the audience to other members of the team or the scientists. He was the commander of the mission and didn't know a damn thing. I was amazed that every single interview, these people look nervous. They don't look genuinely happy or like they've genuinely accomplished something that no man had ever done. They look like they're worried. You know what I'm saying? There was nothing on not one single interview did they come across with any sincerity. They reminded me of the current staged events. You mentioned Sandy Hook, Boston, the Pulse thing. They're all staged. I mean, if you have any discernment in your body at all, you can see through these people as actors. They're insincere. Their stories don't line up. Nothing lines up with logic. But did you see the same thing when you looked at these interviews with these so-called astronauts and people that were so, did they come across as sincere to you, or was it just?
Oh no, not at all. But there was a big difference between the Apollo astronauts and everything else. I do say this: the authority does try to learn from its mistakes, and I think the Apollo astronauts were told. I think the recruitment process was absolutely genuine. I think they were Boy Scouts going into this thing, and they wanted to be heroes. And then at some point, the whole Capricorn One scenario. If anyone hasn't seen the movie, please look it up. Late 70s, really excellent. I think the Capricorn One scenario played into this, which was they sat him down and they said, okay, here's the deal. No one's going to ever be on top of a racket. And really, and that's kind of the side effect of this whole thing, which is you never want to put people on top. I mean, really on top of an ICBM? I mean, it's a pile of liquid explosives. You know, you're really going to put people on top of that thing? No, you're not going to. And so they said, look, you're not going up there. We're going to take you out to an Air Force base. We're going to shoot some footage, and we're going to pretend the whole thing. If you want to use the argument to them, if it makes it easier on them, and say, we just don't have the technology to do it right now, but maybe later we will, and you know, we can do this later, and you just keep kicking the can down the road. The problem is, with the Apollo astronauts, I think they told them why. I think they said, look, there's something up there, there's some sort of barrier, and, you know, they didn't even have to tell them, you know, the Earth was flat. All they said, look, there's a barrier, we can't get out. No one's going to space. We don't know why. We've been trying to break through it for years, and it's not happening. And then you have these, these astronauts who were going to be heroes, and yeah, they're getting ticker tape parades, and they're, you know, getting all these accolades and awards, and they get invited to, you know, can do public speaking things for the rest of their life, and it's too much on them. There's too much guilt, and they don't know what to do. So most of the Apollo astronauts, you know, became recluses. They crawled into bottles. I mean, Neil Armstrong was just dying to tell somebody at that speech where he's saying, you know, that whole truth, hidden protective layer, what the heck was he doing? They were all, you know, they all had a really hard time with it. So I think at some time later, they said, okay, any new astronauts, we're going to tell them they're going to fake stuff. We are not going to tell them anything more than that. We'll make them sign things and say, look, you don't have clearance to ask any questions. Just shoot the footage, get in the ISS simulator, and do it. But you're absolutely right. No astronaut has ever, you know, looked super confident, super happy. That's what was also the big thing, you know, especially like that international press conference from Apollo 11. When they got back, and you had Neil and Buzz and, I can't remember the other guy's name with the mustache, but where they were up there, and they should have been on cloud nine. No play on words there. They should have been absolutely high as a kite and wouldn't, you know, not stop smiling forever. At the very least, because they made it back from the moon alive. You know, for him, not just the American pride thing, and these guys looked so down and so drained. And, you know, yeah, you could tell, you know, anyone, if you look at people that do lie detector stuff and read body language for a living, I'm sure they could watch those interviews and say, oh, yeah, these guys are lying through the teeth. But that's because, yeah, they not only did they not go to, you know, these places, they didn't go into orbit, they didn't go to the moon and do any of this other stuff. They never even got on top of a rocket. They were shuttled off and kept somewhere quiet and secret, which is, I can't wait. You know, one day I swear somebody's going to dig, you know, track down one of the Challenger people. You know, again, look up, you want to have fun, look up Challenger astronauts still alive. I still firmly believe that, where, you know, the Challenger blew up, you know, the rocket blew up, and it's like, okay, what do we do with these people, the astronauts? It's like, okay, we'll just put them in a witness relocation. And, you know, they're all successful business people. And they look, you know, like exactly what, you know, six out of seven of them are still alive. I think one died of natural causes. So yeah, the astronauts, it's ridiculous, but it also allows them, by keeping them out of the loop now, especially with the ISS people, you can let them kind of act, you know, be themselves, and they can be sort of happy and everything, but still some of it wears on them, you know, like, look at Scott Kelly, you know, one of the bald twins that was up there. He was up there for supposedly like a year, if you believe that story. And then yet, once he gets down, what does he do, a book tour? Does he go on talk circuits? No, he quits. He quits NASA as soon as he gets down from there. Why? Why would he quit? You know, did he realize that, you know, this thing is starting to crumble and he didn't want to be anywhere near it? You know, he didn't want to put himself in the crosshairs like Neil deGrasse Tyson has? I go on and on. Here's another little short one for you. Neil deGrasse Tyson, why hasn't he ever been to space? Out of all the scientists, why was he never shoulder tapped? What, nobody could sponsor him? It's like, fine, you know, you didn't want to pay the X $100,000 thing fee to go up there. It's like, why wouldn't somebody else do it? I mean, his channel to get him into space, unless he absolutely flat out refused. Anyway.
Yeah. And, you know, and people that find it incredulous that the government would do this, all you got to do is point out what they did in the 1960s to the American sailors on the USS Liberty. I mean, the average American today still doesn't know about the Israeli strafing, bombing, and torpedoing of a United States vessel, but the media and the White House told everybody in the beginning that it was the Arabs that did it. And then when it came out that it was actually Israelis, they covered it up. They made all of the survivors swear to keep it quiet. And that's actually happened. And that was back in the 1960s, a lie of that magnitude and kept secret that long. And that was just an involvement of one naval vessel, a relatively small naval vessel, in the Mediterranean. And yet they did that. And just to go along with what you're saying, and you don't think that they would lie about NASA and the whole space program and the probably by now trillions, with a T, trillions of dollars spent on nothing? Like you said, and now we recently heard that the Defense Department can't find $6.3 or $6.4 trillion. Mark, how do you lose $6.4 trillion? How do you do that?
Well, nowadays it's you have to cover it up with something bigger. Usually, it's a misdirection. Something, yeah. I'll use the line from Die Hard. It's like when you steal $600, then nobody cares. You steal $600 million, they will find you, unless they think you're already dead. And you know, in this case, yeah, when it comes to trillion dollar heists, you know, it can be done, but usually you have to come up with an operation that's big enough to distract people from the entire thing.
You mean
usually.
like World War III?
Yeah, like World War III.
Okay. I'm going to tell you what, I would love to talk with you for the next 3 hours, but I know you got a life, you got things to do, the audience probably has things they got to do, so what I want to do here at the very end is give the mic over to you for a few minutes, and just talk in general, because you have a lot more contacts than I do in certain areas, a lot of consternation with where we are in the world right now, outside of the flat earth theory. Just get your take on things in general in the geopolitical sphere, because a lot of people have been telling me they feel something big is about ready to happen, bigger even than this. So
I can address that.
Just give us your take on where we are and what's going on.
Sure. If it was me, if I was writing the script on this, I wouldn't. What they're doing now falls into line with what I would expect. And we'll use the American geopolitical climate, which is I have never seen an election in American history, and I've followed elections over the years. Now, I've never voted in my life because I don't believe in the election process. I think it's a waste of time. It's just an illusion, the illusion of choice. But when it comes to I've never seen a political race where it has been so polarizing on both sides, and you'll see where I'm going with this in a second, where you have literally, I mean, I can't believe I'm saying this, but the choice of president of the United States right now is either the jilted wife of an ex-president or a reality television star. Of course, we have instances of, you know, Jesse Ventura became governor of Minnesota, Arnold Schwarzenegger became governor of California. We got that. That isn't president of the United States, right? And people are saying, well, what is that? Why is that a big deal? It's a big deal because if you wanted to, for example, or we're coming down to crunch time, if you wanted to have your president, because remember, a president can only run for 2 terms. However, he can extend that second term indefinitely during a crisis situation. And so people have a choice between Trump and Clinton. You know, most people don't want to choose either of them because they're horrible, horrible candidates. They're awful choices. But if there's a crisis situation, now you have a third candidate, and that is Trump, Clinton, or Obama. Obama doesn't start looking bad anymore. You know, if you had to choose between the three, I mean, most people would be like, well, you know, yeah, he's been horrible, and he's a terrible person, but he's better than these two guys. The question is, what crisis would be involved there to do this? I have always said from day one that Flat Earth feels like a setup, you know, that it feels like it's part of something bigger. You're thinking, well, it is, you know, Flat Earth is the left jab, what's the right hook? Because if it's something bigger than Flat Earth, there's only, you know, you're really limiting yourself to what it can be. There's only a couple things that could be bigger than Flat Earth. But they both boil down to some sort of celestial event. something to where the entire world sees something. And again, because social media is in place, you can get your story straight, you can broadcast this thing, and everybody can, you know, whatever happens, the mainstream media can spin it exactly the way they want it to. And if that means, you know, I don't think it's a Planet X event necessarily, you know, isolated, because you want some sort of explanation with it. I don't think it's as cut and dry as that. Could it be, you know, some sort of revelation from an advanced civilization? You know, some people call it aliens, but, like, are they aliens? If it's an enclosed world, I don't think it's aliens anymore. I think it's, you know, it's not just an advanced civilization that could be outside of this place or could be the part of the team that built it. You don't know. But that's what it feels like we're coming down to, you know, that Flat Earth seems to be this open-minded awakening that people are now getting, you know, they're more accepting to other ideas, to where if something happened, let's say a giant golden spaceship came out of the sky and landed in the middle of London, that people would be like, oh yeah. Yeah, I mean, it wouldn't, you know, it takes away the hands running in the air screaming sort of chaos and turns it into something else. And so that's what if people want to, you know, because I do get that. People say, what do you think is going to happen next? Where do you think we are? If I had to take a bet, I'd say some sort of weird crisis is going to unfold. Now, could it be, you know, some giant terrorist event? Sure, of course. You know, you could stage that very easily. But you can't do a 9/11 again, because no offense, but 9/11 is old hat. You know, it's going to have to be something bigger than that. It's going to have to be, you know, some sort of a dirty bomb or something where an entire city gets leveled, or something international. But once you do that, then a president can, you know, Obama can step in, and multiple presidents all over the place. But they can step in and say, look, we're going to suspend any elections because, you know, it's of instability. And then you go from there to something else. You know, so maybe it starts with something as simple as a terrorist event and ends up with a celestial event. But we got to be coming down to it, because I just can't imagine that you would go to all this trouble and let the elections happen as normal, and then what do you do? Then you're stuck with, you know, one of these two candidates. I can't see it. So anyway, but the super quick version is, Flat Earth, I think, is a piece of a even bigger puzzle. And this puzzle has to also do, Flat Earth is part of where we are. If you want to know the answer to the question of who you are and why you're here, Flat Earth is just part of it. The other part is, whoever built it has to come forward. The saying, I'll end it with this, and it wasn't me that came up with this one, and that is, when the classroom is ready, the teacher enters the room. And that's what I think is coming.
Yeah, I heard a slightly different version. When the student is ready, the teacher will appear.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
We are his children, and up till this point in time, I don't think we were ready. Just pray that we are now. But anyway, I got that 90 minutes out of you, Mark, and it was thoroughly enjoyed it. And I hope you would consider coming back on at some point and continue this discussion.
All right, absolutely. I will. You just let me know, and I'll be there.
All right, Mark, you take care, and again, God bless, and thanks for being on with us.
All right, have a good rest of your day.
Take care.
Bye.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, again, Mark Sargent with the Flat Earth Clues, and again, not to be confused with what the globalists tried to present to us as what the Middle Ages people thought, where you would sail off and just fall off into nothingness, like off the edge of a table. Totally ridiculous. And that's why I prefer the title of Enclosed Earth. It is enclosed and surrounded by an ice wall. It all makes logic and sense. And again, for the debunkers out there that think that this is totally nonsensical or it takes away from the importance of the identity message, no, it does not. From my point of view, to truly identify who's who in the Bible, you have to be a truth seeker. And I've said that for the 17 years, almost 17 years I've been on the air. This By Yahweh's Design program was dedicated on the very first broadcast to truth, to our people, and to truth. And as Mark stated during the interview, there were many, many times people had stories to tell. that needed to be heard, and the mainstream media would not give him a voice. By Yahweh's design did. We've interviewed thousands of people, some at the level of congressmen, some of them at general, colonel, police officers, etc., to get their story out about what the truth was because the media was covering it up. And I'm not going to back off of that, no matter what anybody says, ever. And so when I invite somebody of the magnitude of a Mark Sargent, or I've asked Rob Skiba to be a guest, and so far he has said he will, and Rob will come to bring a ton of biblical material to back up what he says. Truth is truth. And if the way I look at it, all truth leads us to salvation. All right, those Greek words that are translated as salvation, they meant 2,000 years ago to be saved from physical harm here on earth. It had nothing to do with a deliverance or a spiritual epiphany or a transcendental happening to where all of a sudden now you're in this forever zone. And the whole thing that the mainstream church gets into is ridiculous. It had to do with deliverance from harm here on earth from your adversaries, and harm from poison foods, those type of things. And so if I've been lied to, and you have been lied to by the people that we should be able to trust all of these years, there's an agenda. And I consider it the agenda of the wicked. And so if Yahweh said that a sword would proceed from his mouth when he comes on that charger for war, and I always wondered, when Revelation says a sword, he would cut his enemies down with a sword from his mouth. And I used to think, what is that trying to tell me? How about the spoken word? The spoken word, when it's backed up by truth, can cut like a sword. Does it not? As for the naysayers out there, you stay in your zone and stay away from me. I'm going after the truth with whatever power Yahweh gives me until he decides otherwise.